Hospital. Harris reached the rank of commander. Unhappy with the status quo in Annapolis, Harris, a political neophyte, decided to take on the establishment and run for the Maryland State Senate in 1998, and he won by an impressive margin and served while practicing medicine. Harris began serving in the United States House Representatives in 2011 from Maryland's beautiful 1st Congressional District. He serves on the Appropriations Committee and the following subcommittees, Agriculture, Rural Development, Food and Drug Administration, and related agencies, Labor, Health and Human Services, Education, and related agencies, and Homeland Security. So in his free time, Harris enjoys spending time on the Chesapeake Bay with his family and repairing old cars with his son. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Andy Harris. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here with you. I just got back from Cleveland a few days ago. Any of you have been in Cleveland? All right, it's quite a time. Look, this is an exciting time to be a conservative in America. Because it actually makes me recall, as you heard in my introduction, you know, how I got my start in conservatism was that my parents escaped communism. My mother from the Ukraine, my father from Hungary, both waited to come to this country, best country in the world, and waited their turn, came here legally, and raised their family and achieved the American dream. I grew up in the Cold War. You grow up in the War on Terror. And there are a lot of similarities. And I will tell you, this election, many of you will be voting for president the first time. My first vote for president was for Ronald Reagan. Many of you, yeah. First in the primary in 1976, I'll add. This is a similar situation facing the country now. And I remember, as I was growing up, the same thing from liberals that you hear now. Don't worry about Russia. Don't worry about the Cold War. You know, no need to fight the Cold War. You know, pacifism works. They're not a real enemy. It turns out, of course, they were a real enemy. They still are a real enemy. Pacifism doesn't work. We only get peace through strength, which is really the lesson that Ronald Reagan taught the world. And I was part of that buildup. You heard that I joined the Naval Reserve. I joined it in 1988. Just before we won the Cold War, when the president decided to put all the chips in the middle of the table to build up our nation's offensive structure, hopefully never needing it in the military, and Russia collapsed. Soviet Union at that time collapsed. Amid a lot of criticism at the time that he was belligerent, that he was, you know, a warmonger, that he was taking the threat of Russia out of context. It's exactly the same thing we hear now with the war on terror that we're hearing coming out of the administration now. We hear that there's nothing to worry about. That, in fact, Senator Kerry said famously over the weekend that air conditioning is a greater danger to the world than terrorism. That kind of sticking your head in the sand naivete is very, very dangerous. And this time, this November, we get to turn the tide. Because if Hillary Clinton wins the election to the White House, believe me, we will lose the war on terror. Because she will continue the failed policy of the Obama administration, a policy that I will tell you, you will, as you gain more experience in politics and in looking and seeing what goes on in the world, you'll realize just how dangerous this administration's foreign policy has been. This administration's foreign policy has been an unbelievable disaster. Again, to someone growing up in the Reagan era, when we were proud, when he restored America's greatness, I remember the election of 1980, when he ran against Jimmy Carter, who couldn't apologize more for the United States. This is deja vu all over again. It's the exact same situation, a weak Democrat president who refuses to name the enemy, replaced by a strong Republican leader who will lead us back to greatness. Now, there are probably people in this room for whom Donald Trump was not the ideal candidate. Okay, get over it. The fact of the matter is, the fact of the matter is that this election is as every presidential election is, and look, there'll be other candidates, there'll be a Libertarian, a Green candidate, this election is between Hillary Clinton's vision and Donald Trump's vision. And Hillary Clinton's vision is not only a continuation of the last 8 years, but actually steering the country further left, because she has to, because she had to respond to Bernie Sanders. So it's going to be a stark contrast between that vision and the vision, at least at what I think that Mr. Trump projects, and projects very well, and that's why he won the nomination, is he projects leadership. He projects the idea that America should be great again. It's a pretty simple concept. But you know, it'll escape people that America, over the last 8 years, has stopped being great. The fact of the matter is, we're not viewed as a world leader. We're viewed actually with suspicion in many countries around the world because leaders around the world don't know what we stand for. Because the president can't say what we stand for. He can't even say what we're against. The fact of the matter that he can't put the words radical, Islamic, and terrorist in the same sentence, those three words in the same sentence, means he just doesn't get it. And the rest of the world stands by and just watches. Because the rest of the world is used to seeing American leadership. They've been used to it for 30 years, and it's collapsed over the past 8 years. They were used to a world where America, with the principles of liberty and freedom, you know, we're the only country in the world, I believe, that actually raises a large army so that we never have to use it. That's really very different from every other country throughout history. Countries raise armies to defeat other nations and capture them and then take them over economically. Our idea of victory in World War II was to raise a large army, win the war against Nazis and fascists, and then help economically the countries we conquered to become world leaders economically, Germany, Japan. That's very different. That's a very different concept. But that's the concept that we're lacking now. Without a strong American military, a strong American leader who realizes our place in the world is a leadership place and leadership position, we won't fare well. We just won't fare well. So I'm going to urge you, and we've got 15 minutes left, because I think I stand between you and lunch, for questions and answers on any topic, but I urge you, this is a historic election. This election really is going to be as historic as the election in 1980. And it's going to be a major major division in the road which way this country goes. Because if Hillary Clinton wins and appoints three or four Supreme Court justices, as is probably likely, because fact of the matter is, if you win one term in America now, you usually win two term unless you're totally incompetent like Jimmy Carter. She will probably appoint three or four Supreme Court justices, and the court will be changed for a generation. And to those of you, because you'll meet conservatives who say, I can't vote for Donald Trump, I can't vote for Donald Trump. Look, let me tell you something. Presidents come and go. Supreme Courts last a long, long time. You know, you only elect a president for 4 years, and usually because they get reelected for 8 years, but a 40-year-old Supreme Court justice or a 45-year-old Supreme Court justice will serve for 40 years, will serve until some of you are on Social Security. Okay? That's the facts. That's what this election is all about. Donald Trump, to his credit, because people say, you know, the first way you judge a president is you see what decisions they make. The two decisions he made was he named the list of Supreme Court nominees who he would propose, every single one light years better than who Hillary Clinton will propose, all conservative, they're not activist judges. And then the second choice he made was Mike Pence for vice president. Now, do we have anybody from Indiana here? You can applaud. I've known Mike because we overlapped for 2 years in the U.S. House of Representatives. I, in fact, was the only, got to know him quite well, became quite good friends with him. He actually came in, did an event for me during my election in 2010. And I was the only congressman, actually, who was not from Indiana, who went to his swearing-in on that very, very cold day in Indianapolis when he was sworn in 4 years ago, three and a half years ago. Mike is a conservative's conservative. Mike will make a great president one day. I'm convinced of that. And I really do hope that this launches his national career, because Mike is he's a conservative's conservative, top to bottom, whether it's on social issues, pro-life issues, family issues, military strength issues, economy, regulation, taxes, down the list. He is a great choice for vice president, and I look forward to helping him and Mr. Trump turn this country around, truly making America great again after the November election. So anyway, those are my prepared comments. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions anyone has about any issues that are facing us or facing Congress.
Hello, my name is Ethan Christopher. My only question is that, do you feel that Ruth Bader Ginsburg's comments are appropriate for a Supreme Court justice, as she made comments about Donald Trump as our nominee?
No. Honestly, she should resign. The bottom line is, you can't... It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable that a Supreme Court justice, sitting Supreme Court justice... Now, there are only two explanations. One is she just doesn't care anymore. The other, actually, is that she's so old that she doesn't know how she should behave. Neither of those are adequate explanations. The fact of the matter is, it's completely unacceptable for a Supreme Court justice to have made that statement. She can think it privately. Because, of course, look, Supreme Court, just like everybody else, they have private thoughts. You cannot be public, because we hold our Supreme Court to be impartial arbiters about the greatest thing we have, our Constitution. And when she comes up and says, no, that Article II person couldn't be an Article II president. Totally inappropriate.
And do you think Merrick Garland is an appropriate nominee for a Supreme Court seat?
It doesn't make any difference, because he's not going to get a vote. He'll never be on the Supreme Court. So my opinion in the House, of course, makes no difference at all, because only the Senate makes a difference. But look, the president... the president is still trying to play the Merrick Garland card, to somehow convince America that in the midst of this presidential election, we should appoint his nominee, or we should confirm his nominee. It's not going to get done. I fully understand why he does it. It's a great political move on his part. It's also, I think Mitch McConnell hit it on the head. I mean, it's the Biden-Schumer policy. You just don't confirm Supreme Court nominees for a lame duck president in his last year.
Good morning. My name is Abby Kate Christman, and I'm from Wingate University in North Carolina. First of all, I want to thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you. An important state, North Carolina. We have to win North Carolina.
I am looking at going into the medical field, and I was wondering how you would say to get started in politics and manage working in the medical field at the same time.
Wow. Well, there are two routes you can take, and it's interesting because the roots of a couple of the Democrats who are physicians in Congress actually were very different. They got involved in public health, so they didn't go into the practice of medicine per se. They got into public health, and then that's easy to merge with a political career. Most of the Republicans, actually, like myself, had almost complete medical careers, and then decided to step up. And I think the true tradition of a part-time legislator, so not a career politician. You actually do something, learn about the world, become an expert in something, and then help the country by stepping up into a political role. I can't judge which of those is better or worse. Those are those two possible paths. So on the one hand, if you're interested in public health, go into public health, which is easy to merge into health policy and politics. On the other hand, there's nothing wrong with just having a career in the medical field, paying attention to politics, and then waiting. In politics, those of you who want to run for office, you'll learn this. You have to be in the right place at the right time, and you have to wait. You have to wait for the right place at the right time. And I enjoyed, and it was an honor to practice medicine for 30 years, really waiting for the right place and the right time.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for coming to speak to us. And this does mean a lot to me as a conservative trapped in Maryland's District 7. Or what
wow.
passes for it.
Yeah.
I believe, if I remember correctly, you said that you were still practicing medicine.
Yes, that's right.
How easy is it to balance the needs of your patients with the needs required to be a legislator as well as a family man?
Well, I do practice, but I only practice about 12 days a year. It turns out there are very strange ethics laws in the House. Which greatly limit the amount of time I can practice. But I practice about 12 days a year in a community hospital. Again, I've practiced anesthesia for 30 years. It's a privilege to take care of patients. So I gain a lot when I practice in the operating room, because in an operating room, You see a wide, not only you see the patients you're taking care of, but you deal with a wide range of people, of a demographic, from the, you know, the surgeons and nurses you're working with to the people who clean the floors and stock the supplies. And it's very interesting to hear what the real world thinks. Because, you know, when you get inside the Beltway, and we're inside the Beltway right now, there is this, and you hear this all the time. I mean, I just heard it. You hear the some of the comments coming out of the Democratic National Convention about, you know, how Mr. Trump's comments, his, you know, he was trying to fearmonger. Look, this is what people are actually thinking. You know, when you pick up the paper every day, and there is literally a terrorist attack every other day in Europe, people actually do get scared. They actually worry about their security. You know, they don't live inside the bubble of a Secret Service protected, a vice president or presidency or a presidential candidate. And that's what you hear. So it's very interesting. My time in the operating room is very interesting because I do hear what the real world thinks about politics. Sometimes, unfortunately, about politicians too, but that's because we know what our favorability rating is or isn't. But thanks for the question.
Thank you very much.
Hi there, my name's Katie Richter, and this is a very generic question, but being a physician, you have a unique perspective to bring to the table. Mm-hmm. With either Hillary or Trump winning the election, how do you see the healthcare industry changing? The ramifications are already starting to come down, you know, with the triple aim objective that hospitals have from the Affordable Care Act and whatnot. So what are your colleagues, you know, what are your fears and concerns? And then on the political side, what are you hearing? Like, what do you think we'll be seeing?
Sure. Let's just start with if Hillary gets elected, we will end up with a single. We probably won't, because the House will be Republican after this election. And that's not through some great miracle of greatness of people in the House or the majority in the House. It's because we have a heck of a lot of Republican governors and legislatures who drew good redistricting maps 8 years ago. That's fact. That's why it is. So we're going to keep the House. Hillary would like to go to a single-payer system. Look, she'd like Medicare for all. And I will tell you that we can't afford it, and it is not, the only way you can afford that kind of system is by rationing. Rationing in some way, shape, or form. That's the only way government can control costs is through rationing. I think that Donald Trump, if he's elected, we will roll back the Affordable Care Act. And I have to tell you, the Affordable Care Act, from a person who's, you know, studied health policy for 15 years, I actually have a master's, wasn't mentioned, but I have a master's in health policy as well. It's totally predictable what's happening. The Affordable Care Act did nothing to control cost except through the rationing of limiting which doctors you can see, things like this, which Americans don't want. They don't want that. They won't accept it. So what we have to do, and I've said this, is we have to go to a consumer-oriented, market-driven healthcare system. Just like you select every other product, if you go out to buy, name the product, a computer, you go and you shop for price and you shop for value. You go and you read reports, you read reviews, and you decide some people will want, you know, the gaming computer that costs $1,000, and some people will want the stripped down Toshiba that costs $199 on sale at Walmart. But it's your choice. And you read reviews and you educate yourself and then you make a price value judgment. None of that goes on in healthcare right now. None of it. And partially because as the government gets involved, price transparency disappears. You know, and I give you a million examples, but price transparency and consumer shopping and controlling prices through the marketplace goes out the window. So we have to deal with that at some point, because otherwise the cost of health care, because Americans do demand good health. Look, and we have good health care. There's no question about it. I mean, I've seen healthcare systems around the world, worked at Hopkins with people trained in healthcare systems around the world. When I say it tongue in cheek, but when one of the princes in Saudi Arabia fuels up his jet to take care of a medical problem, they go to the United States. That's where they go. They don't go to Canada. They don't go to Cuba, because you hear that, oh, the great Cuban medical system. Really? How many Saudi princes land their 747s on the runway in Havana to get medical care? None. They come to the United States, because we do have the potential to deliver this health care nationwide. What restricts it is government interference and regulation. That really is true.
And just, yeah, I have a quick follow-up real quick. Do you think that the triple aim is going to be an effective way to help our healthcare system. And for those of you who don't know what the triple aim is, it's how hospitals get the reimbursement, patient outcomes, cost savings, and patient satisfaction.
Here's the problem. The patient outcome is determined by whom? Somebody sitting in a cubicle down the street in CMS who have never taken care of a patient, and I can give you examples of this as an anesthesiologist, where they gauged the quality of my care by certain criteria only 5 years later to determine that criteria is all wrong. That's the trouble. You have a bureaucrat determining what is an adequate patient outcome. So for instance, I'll just give you this example because this is just, you'll all understand this. So Medicare, one of the quality outcomes is whether or not a patient is readmitted to the hospital within 30 days, okay? So first of all, you have this, for a physician, you have this kind of quandary because I really don't want to keep my patient too long in a hospital because I'm gauged by how long I keep them, but I don't want them to be readmitted within 30 days, so I kind of have to guess right. So, and I usually guess on sending a patient home early. But then if they come back within 30 days, they created this new status called observation, which is not admission. But you go to a room right next to a person who's admitted in the same type of bed, same room, same floor, but they created a paperwork entry called you're in observation status, not readmission status. And that satisfies CMS as not being readmitted. Because we've totally distorted what healthcare is all about. Well, you know, it's how you fill out the form. You know, the greatest example in the VA system. Look, I worked in a VA system. We will never solve the VA system until we privatize it. Never. Ever. We will never deliver quality care to our veterans. That's a fact. What's the proof? The proof is they made up these waiting lists. Because some bureaucrats said you have to have an appointment within 30 days, so they just fudged it. And they call that quality care. When you got government involved in health care, watch out. The only thing they care about is a budget. It's the only thing the government cares about when it delivers health care. Don't let them fool you. They have no concern for the quality of the care. It's other than whether it achieves their budget or not. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Chance Kanzler. I'm an economics student at Middle Tennessee State University. Actually, you might know my representative of Congress, Phil Rowe, another doctor.
I know Dr. Rowe very, very well.
And so part of Tennessee's first congressional district. Mm-hmm. I'm a simple man from East Tennessee. I'm fiscally conservative, socially conservative. Mm-hmm. And what you said about privatizing medicine and healthcare just makes sense to me from an economic standpoint and from something that I see every day on the ground, it works. But this election season, I have been very disappointed in my chosen party, the Republican Party, in Donald Trump. And now you earlier said to get over it, but I do want to ask you a question. This man who said that his sister, who is pro-abortion and anti-constitution, would make a great Supreme Court justice. He led his daughter, Ivanka Trump, who made a wonderful speech at the RNC, but she is a registered Democrat in New York. She can't even vote for her own father and couldn't in the primary. Whenever he was asked by a reporter would he condemn David Duke's support of his campaign, and David Duke, if everyone doesn't know, is the former Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan. Me from the South, we know what the Klan is. They hate black people, they hate freedom, and they love racism. And yet, Trump was like, hey, I don't know who David Duke is. I don't know if I can condemn it. And the reporter was like, well, he's the head of the KKK. And Trump was like, well, I don't know what the KKK is. Why should I condemn him? It's not like he was Muslim or Mexican.
All right.
So now my question is, why should I vote for Donald Trump when he has been pro-choice until 4 years ago, 2012? He was pro-choice his entire life until 2012. Why should I, as a fiscal and socially conservative person, whom I assume we're in a room of conservative people, why should we vote for him over Hillary Clinton, who is corruption incarnate, and him, who is a Democrat pretending to be a Republican, as far as I can tell? I've not been proven or seen anything to prove otherwise.
All right. No, look, you bring up the argument... You bring up the argument I hear all the time. But an election is a choice between two people. That's it. You know, you can say, well, I'll vote for Gary, whatever his name is, the former
Mexican. Gary Johnson. Gary Johnson.
Gary. And you can vote for the Green Party candidate, but your vote doesn't count. I mean, you might as well just stay home. Literally, you might as well just stay home. So the choice is, do I want Hillary Clinton or do I want Donald Trump? What does Donald Trump bring with him? He brings with him a Senate majority. If Donald Trump wins the election, we retain the Senate. Period. Full stop. Ask any political analyst. Donald Trump wins the election, we retain the Senate. We retain a strong House majority. He appoints people to the Supreme Court. And in the end, his policies, the House is a conservative House. He can't get his he couldn't get a liberal policy through the conservative House if he was going to try. Now, why isn't he going to try? He isn't going to try because Donald Trump knows what it takes, is going to know what it takes to get reelected. Because nobody wants to be reelected for only one, to be elected for one term. They all look, what they say, sworn in on the 23rd? By January 24th, you're counting on your reelection already. He knows he has to rule as a conservative to win the Republican nomination 4 years from now. He has to. Because he will get challenged by a conservative successfully if he doesn't. He will. So what's he going to do? No matter what his personal preferences are, but I will tell you, on the issue of, for the pro-life issue, if you listen to his reasoning for becoming pro-life, I like it. I like Mitt Romney's reason. You know, Mitt Romney, a lot of people said Mitt Romney was not pro-life, but I will tell you, and I know because I was in that struggle, he actually vetoed the stem cell research bill in Massachusetts. That takes a lot of political courage, and I know because I fought that fight in Maryland. It takes a lot of political courage. But a lot of people say, well, he's not really pro-life. Yeah, he really is. And Donald Trump's reason, he has a valid reason that he gives for changing his mind. Now, I don't fault people for changing their mind. I go out, I'm a pro-lifer, I go out and try to change people's minds all day. And I don't hold it against someone if they change their mind, to my point of view. So I would say, this choice, if you think that we can survive another 4 years on the path we've been on for 8 years, then stay home, don't vote for Donald Trump. However, if you think a Republican in the White House with a Republican majority in the Senate and Republican appointees to the Supreme Court is important, there's only one choice. Is it the best choice? No, I was a Ben Carson guy. I mean, I endorsed Ben Carson. But in the end, Ben Carson didn't win. Donald Trump did. So he's the standard bearer. Anyway, yeah, I think we're going to run up against a hard stop. Thank you very much. So we just keep on going. We'll have a lightning round, I guess, or something. Yeah.
Hi, Congressman Harris. My question to you is, what are the values and principles that make our country an exceptional country?
The bottom line is, and I thought about this a lot, especially over, I'm wearing my Blue Lives Matter button. And I thought about this a lot, yeah. And I urge you. You have to ask, and where'd the fellow go? Yeah. You have to ask, what makes this country different? And what makes this country truly, really unique? And it's interesting. I was watching one of those PBS shows, one of those British police shows they have on PBS. And, the officer comes knocking on someone's door, and they ask to do a search. And apparently, in Britain, you can do a search without a search warrant as long as you suspect that a crime has been committed. Something. I mean, and you're going like, "Wow, this is," as an American, you go, "This is a foreign thought." You want to come into my house, you got to have a search. The fact of the matter is that we're a country with the rule of law. That's bottom line, and our law is constitutional-based law based on liberty and freedom. That's really exceptional. Now, when does this start slipping away? Well, it starts slipping away when the president exceeds his Article II authorities and begins to act like someone who was elected under Article I of the Constitution. It's extended when the president blames law enforcement. Really? You blame law enforcement in this country? The thin blue line is what separates us from chaos. And sure, are there bad apples in any bunch? Are there bad doctors? Sure there are. But you don't condemn the vast majority for the actions of a few. And that's what this president is doing. This president is honestly promoting lawbreaking. And that is stunning. That is just stunning. His lack of support for law enforcement. And look, he pays the lip service. I get it. But when you really listen to what he says after some of these events. And look, I'm from Maryland. We're ground zero, man. We're Freddie Gray. We're ground zero. Let's look at the scorecard. Four prosecutions of police officers, four of the six been prosecuted, zero convictions. That's a breakdown of the rule of law. When you have a prosecutor in Baltimore City who's going to ruin the lives of six police officers for a political advantage, it's a breakdown of the rule of law. So what I think is great about this country, we are a nation of the rule of law, and we should resist the breakdown of the rule of law wherever we see it. And we see it all around us now, starting from the White House, ending up in the Baltimore City Prosecutor's Office. And that's a real shame, because this country is so distinctly different. And we're spoiled. I mean, I had my parents would tell me about the things they couldn't do. You know, my mother escaped from the Ukraine and never saw her mother again for the next 40 years. Her mother lived behind the Iron Curtain, never saw her. And you go, in this day and age, really? Somebody couldn't visit someone? No, you couldn't. Actually, you couldn't. Never underestimate how great this country is, and help restore the greatness, because it really does need restoration. Yeah.
Hey, I'm Josh from Knoxville, Tennessee, and I was just curious. I hope this doesn't happen, but from all your experience, do you think that the 21st century is going to have bigger wars than the 20th century?
Wow. You know, there'll be different wars. There'll certainly be different. I will tell you, and I tell people this, obviously, the war on terror is a very different war from any war America ever fought, because it's a religious war. And you think about it. I mean, the wars we've fought up till now have never been a religious war. The war that is going on is a war between people of the Islamic faith and the infidels, which has been going on for 1,400 years. I mean, this is not a new war. It's new here in the United States. It's new with involvement in the United States. But you're fighting a very different war, because to us, the idea of strapping a bomb onto our body and walking into a marketplace and blowing up women and children is just a very foreign idea. But it's not a foreign idea in to that believer. That creates a very different kind of war. It will be a war. There will be a terrorist. Unless we stand up and become leaders, there will be terror throughout the world for decades. Now, with regards to other wars, the characters of wars has changed greatly because of the weapons used. My greatest fear is that Iran or another state aligned or potentially aligned, like Pakistan, with terrorists who possess nuclear capability, will start a war that would be unlike any, because, and you all know, I mean, compared to what we dropped on Nagasaki and Hiroshima, there is no comparison between what a modern nuclear weapon can do and what those atomic bombs did. That's my greatest fear, is the uncontrollability of nuclear weapons. And again, you control them from a position of strength. We don't have a position of strength. Our negotiations with Iran were a farce. They were a farce. And literally, you can talk about the lack of American leadership and losing face. I mean, Iran flagrantly violates the agreement they just signed a little over a year ago, just celebrated the one-year anniversary. And the response from the White House, let's buy heavy water from them. Let's actually subsidize their nuclear program. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
Oh, yeah. Hi. So I know you said this was impossible, but in the event that Trump wins and the Republicans lose the Senate majority.
I don't think that would happen. But, okay. I mean, it's always possible. But I think we retain the Senate majority even if Trump loses. But if he wins, there is almost no question that we'll retain the Senate majority.
Okay.
Yeah. But go on. Yeah, if we don't.
Yeah, if that happens and yes. he proposes a really conservative constitutional justice to the Supreme Court, be possible that the Senate would reject the nominee and force him to propose someone more moderate?
I kind of think that if the Senate tries to stick it in his eye, he'll stick it right back. He's just that kind of guy. Sure, is it possible? Yeah. I don't think he's that kind of personality. I mean, the fact of the matter is that it's a prerogative of the president. Would he be able to appoint as conservative a justice? Maybe not. But I view Donald Trump as a guy who's like, well, then that nominee is going to be there, and you want to reject him, I'll just put up another one. We'll go as many rounds as it takes until he wins. I just view that he has a different leader. He is going to look at that as a test of his leadership, and I think that he has he's going to win that battle. But yes, it is possible. Look, it's possible that even if we have a majority, but we don't have 60, because remember, I mean, you can filibuster a Supreme Court nominee. We left that intact, that the Democrats could attempt to do that. But place it in context. If we have a Republican president, a Republican Senate, and a Republican House, the mandate from the country will be clear. And I think the Democrats would, they ought to be careful about testing that. It's so early on, because remember, this will be within weeks. I mean, literally, one of the first things that President Trump would do is to propose a nominee to replace Justice Scalia, and in the first 100 days, it would be exceptional for the Democrats to try that. Would they try it? I don't know. Chuck Schumer, I guess, would be the new minority leader. I guess he's willing to pick that fight, but. It's theoretically possible. I don't think it's going to happen. And I think we get, the ages of the Supreme Court justices just as much as I do. The next president will appoint, I think, at least three in the first 4-year term, which is pretty exceptional for a president to have the opportunity to appoint three justices. Anyway, listen, thank you very much. I'm going to stay around for a little bit of while. If anybody has any questions you didn't get to ask at the microphones, ask. Yes? Go ahead, shout it out.
Okay. I had a question because once I'm a rising freshman at Hillsdale College, by the way. I'm from the state of Georgia. And so my mom is considering to have me get my health insurance from the Obamacare exchanges. I want to avoid that nightmare.
Yeah, yeah.
I do not trust the government to hold my personal information because
right. So the question is, yeah,
but my mom's telling me that she wants to avoid paying a very expensive fine. How can I convince her to, instead, despite paying the fine, get my health insurance from a private insurer
Sure. Look, if you think the fine is expensive, wait until you see the premium on the Affordable Care Act policy. They are not cheap. I tell people, if you don't get the subsidy, but I think around 80% of people get the subsidy on the exchange to subsidize that premium. It is by far the most expensive insurance you most people have ever seen. And even with that, it fails. So I would attempt every alternative because they're just simply not affordable. For a young, healthy person, and all of you, for fun, I mean, how many of you have checked what your premium would be on the Obamacare exchange? Go, honestly, just for fun one day, go log on and see what you would pay as a young, healthy person. I don't know any young, healthy person who would buy that insurance. Honestly, you'd be a bad economic actor if you bought that insurance. An irrational economic actor, I guess, is what, because we had somebody, who's in economics, and we like to think that we're all rational economic actors. Nobody rationally would buy Obamacare insurance if they're young and healthy. It's priced too high, purposefully, to dilute the high risk, because they decided to go an opposite way from a lot of states. Maryland, we had a high risk pool, very successful. The premiums for the high risk subsidized through a tax on all hospitalizations, so everybody participated. Trouble with Obamacare is only the Obamacare exchange participants share in that risk. So you basically have all the high risk people, and you have some young, healthy people who will never buy the insurance because it's too expensive.
So
that's the alternative.
Find
any alternative to buying that. It's totally unaffordable and unrealistically expensive. I mean, it's way more expensive than the actual risk that they cover for you in that exchange, and designed that way, and that's why it's failing. It will fail under its own weight. There's no question about it. It'll just be painful to watch. And what you'll hear is the liberals will call for single payer. They'll call for Medicare for all. They'll call for Medicaid expansion. All the things that don't work, they'll call for expanding that to solve the Affordable Care Act. So. Anyway, listen, thank you very much. Thanks all for your activism. Keep the faith.
All right, let's give Congressman Harris another round of applause. All right, students, your lunch is in the next room, the Continental Ballroom, but please be back in your seats at 1 o'clock. So back in your seats at 1 o'clock. Thank you.
restrain myself to give up on the past, cause I've frozen time between hearses and caskets. Lost control when I panicked at the acid test.